we can immediately get logistic regression. And we are going to see later that if you combine several of these units, you can get a neural network that is more expressive than just a linear classifier. So, I don't know why, but this stopped working. So the other activation function that is very used in neural networks is the hyperbolic tangent, or tanh, which is very similar to the sigmoid, except that the output, instead of being squashed between 0 and 1, it's squashed between minus 1 and 1. But the shape of the function is essentially the same. And in fact, the two are related by this linear expression. So the sigmoid equals 1/2 of 1 plus the tanh of z over 2. So an important difference with respect to the sigmoid is that this is not strictly positive. It can be positive or negative. But it's also bounded, and it's also strictly increasing. And again, if you combine layers with units like this, then you can get a more expressive neural network. So a recent activation function that got very popular, and actually, it's been associated with this new progress in deep learning, is the rectified linear unit, which, unlike the sigmoid and the tanh, is not completely squashing. So basically, what this does is it looks at the input. If the input is negative, then it truncates to zero. Otherwise, it's linear. So it's a piecewise linear activation function. So one of the reasons why this got so popular is that this activation function is less prone to vanishing gradients. I didn't explain yet what vanishing gradients are. So in the afternoon, when I'm talking about recurrent neural networks, I'm going to go back to the problem of vanishing gradients. But the main point is that if you combine many of these layers, many sigmoids, or many tanh units, in a deeper network, and you try to compute the gradient, then the gradients of the units that are closer to the input are going to decrease exponentially fast with the depth of the neural network. And because the rectified linear units are still linear, if the pre-activation is positive, they are less prone to this problem. And this is one of the reasons why they got so popular after they were introduced in 2011. Non-negative, increasing. So it's not upper-bounded, unlike the sigmoid and the tanh. Another detail is that it's not differentiable at zero, but this is not going to be a problem, as we're going to see. We can still do gradient pair propagation by using something close to a subgradient. One important feature is that if the pre-activation is negative, then the response of this neuron is going to be exactly zero. So if you have a neural network with many neurons, what's going to happen in practice is that the activity of the neurons is going to be sparse, because many of them are going to basically be inactive because of this response function. So we have seen before the break that a linear classifier can find a separating function if the data is linearly separable, but it cannot solve, for example, the XOR problem. And this is a strong limitation of a single neuron. So on the other hand, if you compose these units, we get what is called a multi-layer neural network, and this is going to have more representation power than just a linear classifier. So the key idea here is that we're going to add intermediate layers of neurons before the final output layer. And each of these hidden units is going to compute some kind of representation of the input. This is where representation learning comes into play. And it's going to propagate that representation forwards in the network. And by doing that, by learning these intermediate representations, this is going to increase the expressive power of the network and allowing us to build classifiers that are more complex and nonlinear. So in a way, this is kind of similar as what we achieve by introducing latent variables in probabilistic models, but you don't have this probabilistic this probability semantics. And another name for multilayer neural networks is feed-forward neural networks. So these two things just mean the same. It means that you're just propagating the inputs forwards without any recurrences. So here's what you have if you just use a single hidden layer. So with a single hidden layer, should get the laser. Does anyone has a laser pointer? Okay. I had one, but I don't know where I put it.
You just need the laser, right?
Yep. Okay, thanks. Okay, so this is the hidden layer. This is the input layer, and this is the output. So this is a neural network with a single hidden layer. It's already more expressive than just a linear classifier, because the linear classifier does not have this layer. Using the definition of the artificial neuron, we have a pre-activation in the hidden layer using this expression. So this is just an affine function of the inputs. We get z of x in the end. So here we are assuming that we have k units in the hidden layer. And then we have a hidden layer activation that applies the nonlinearity g using the same nonlinearity in all the hidden units. So this bold-faced g means that we are just applying these vector-wise. So applying this to the same nonlinearity to every unit. So this could be tanh, sigmoids, rectified linear units, whatever you prefer. And finally, we have an output layer activation. So in this example, we can just assume that this is binary classification. So we just have a single output unit. And the output layer activation could be just another nonlinearity applied to, that takes as inputs the hidden representations that we got in this layer. With its own bias term. So for example, if this is a sigmoid, then we get logistic, this layer would be equivalent to logistic regression, but now we have this additional hidden layer. This shows how we can build a neural network with a single hidden unit to solve a binary classification problem. But in practice, many problems involve predicting multiple classes, like the topic classification example that I was showing in the beginning. To be able to do multi-class classification, we need more than one output unit. We need multiple units, one per class. For example, in topic classification, could be one for sports, another for politics, another for technology, and so on. One way of doing that is to make each output estimate the conditional probability of that class condition on the inputs and predict the class that has the highest estimated probability. So we're going to look at two activation functions that are suitable for problems like this. The most used is the softmax activation. There is a recent one that we introduced in a recent paper called SparseMax. I'm going to talk just a little bit about that. So the softmax activation is very simple. The way it works, so the problem is if you look again at the neural network, now we are going to have several output units here, and we have so after applying the pre-activation, we are going to have a score for every possible label that we can predict. And what we need to do is to convert this vector of real numbers that can be positive, negative, and so on. We need to convert it to a probability distribution. So the most standard way of doing that is to use the softmax activation function, which is basically just exponentiating each of these numbers and normalizing everything. So the exponentiation is making sure that we get something positive in the end, and the normalization makes sure that we get something that normalizes to one. So this is going to become a valid probability distribution. So in this particular case, the distribution is going to be strictly positive because the exponential function is strictly positive. So we never get probability of zero to any topic. So this is fine for many problems, but in problems in which we really want a sparse probability distribution in the end, we are not going to get that with softmax unless we do some hacks like thresholding the probabilities and truncating to zero. So another possibility, another possible activation that we can use if we want to get exactly zero probability to some labels is to use a different activation called sparse max. So this is kind of, we can regard this as a sparse friendly alternative to softmax, where instead of exponentiating the real numbers and normalizing them, we are computing an Euclidean projection of our vector z. So this contains all the pre-activations. We can regard these as scores for the candidate labels. We're going to project this vector into the probability simplex. So this is just an Euclidean projection operation. And the output of that, by definition, is going to be a probability distribution. And it turns out that this kind of Euclidean projections, they are often sparse, because it's often the case that this Euclidean projection is going to hit the boundary of the simplex. And if it does hit the boundary, then some of the coordinates, some of the labels, will get exactly probability zero. So no need to thresholding or truncating in this case. So interestingly, and you know, when we first proposed this, we didn't know anything about. But maybe because in neural networks, then you need to backpropagate, you need to compute gradients and so on. So it's not obvious at first sight how we can compute the gradients of this function. This is an arg mean, so there's no derivative rule that you can apply to compute a gradient. But in fact, if you work out the math, and the details are in this paper, we can actually show that this has very similar properties as the softmax. It's still differentiable almost everywhere, except in a finite number of points. It has, in addition, the ability of producing sparse distributions, as I already told you. And this forward operation, so this computation, the projection onto the simplex, it corresponds to a soft thresholding operation. So I'm not going to derive that result, but this means that we take our vector z, and we are going to subtract a fixed quantity for all dimensions. And if the result of that is negative, then it will truncate it to zero. So the only thing that we need to do to solve this problem is to compute what is the amount of threshold that you need to apply. And doing this is quite efficient. So we can do this in linear time. And backpropagating is even cheaper than the necessary work that we need to do for softmax. So is there any question regarding this? So this is a not very standard activation function because it was very recently proposed. If you want to understand more of the fundamentals of neural networks, it's easier just to think about the softmax, which is a more trivial operation. So just to give a flavor about how softmax and sparsemax compare to each other, here's a representation in two dimensions. So in two dimensions, the softmax becomes the logistic function, the sigmoid. So just to be clear, what we are doing here is we are parameterizing our inputs are like in two dimensions. We just have two inputs, and we are saying that the second coordinate is zero. And we do this without losing any generality, because if we add a constant to all members, to all elements, to all dimensions, before doing the softmax, we get the same result. So without losing generality, we can just parameterize our pre-activations to have this form. And then we are plotting so the first dimension of softmax with respect to t. So this is what this graph is showing. If you do that for softmax, we get the sigmoid function. And this is a very easy result to derive, because this becomes exponential of zero, this becomes exponential of minus t, and we need to, like for this first coordinate, we have again in the numerator the exponential of zero, and everything becomes the expression for the sigmoid. To compare, so what we get with sparse max is something that is a piecewise linear, we can regard it as an approximation of the sigmoid that is piecewise linear. So it still has the same shape, it's still a squashing function, but it's piecewise linear instead of having the shape of a sigmoid. So in three dimensions, you get something similar. So in this case, we are parameterizing our three numbers by just using two coordinates, fixing one to zero, and plotting everything as a function of t1 and t2. And again, we get the same graphical representation, where softmax is kind of a three-dimensional or a b-dimensional surface that looks like a sigmoid. And for sparse max, you get a piecewise linear function. OK, so this small detour was just to explain what happens if you have multiple classes in the output layer. So let's go back again to neural networks, the entire network, in the general case. And let's assume that instead of just having a single hidden layer, we have multiple hidden layers. So here we have not just H1, but H1, H2, and we can have more than just two hidden layers. So the story is pretty much the same. For every layer, we have a pre-activation. So we have a z function, z of x, that is computed as a fine function of the input to that layer, which in this case is the previous, the activation coming from the previous layer. So the input of H2 is going to be the representations computing in H1. And then we have an activation that applies a nonlinearity to all these pre-activations. And again, in the end, we have an output layer activation, which now we are assuming the full general case where you can have multiple units. So we have some vector function that takes as input the layer that is immediately below that one. So an important result about neural networks that characterize their expressiveness is the universal approximation theorem, which was established in 1989. So there is an earlier result by Sibenko, and almost later on there was a more general result by Hornick that states that a neural network with just a single hidden layer and a linear output unit is able to approximate any continuous function arbitrarily well if you have enough hidden units. So of course this doesn't tell us anything about how many hidden units we need. There are some cases that show that to approximate some very complex functions, we are going to need an exponential number of hidden units. So this is not practical. It also doesn't tell us how to parameterize the network. It just tells us that it's possible to approximate the function. I don't know about concrete results for deeper networks, but there are some examples that show that there are functions that you can approximate compactly with a network with two or three hidden layers that you cannot with a single layer neural network. So functions that for which you have a polynomial number of parameters in the network if you go deeper, but that require exponentially many hidden layers if you want, exponentially many hidden units if you want to do it with a single layer neural network. Okay, is there any question at this point? No? Everything is clear? Is this new to anyone, or did everyone already knew about this? Okay, not much reaction. So, who had taken a course or did actual work with neural networks before? Okay, so it's about half of the audience. So for those, I guess this is just a recap of things that are well known. Okay, so let's give an example. So this is actually funnier if I had internet here, but I probably don't have. So there is this thing that was released by Google recently. So there is TensorFlow, which is a software for coding neural networks. And more recently, so they released TensorFlow about 1 year ago. And more recently, there was this Playgrounds tool, which is a way of visualizing a toy neural network and to play a little bit with learning rates, different activations, adding inner layers, looking at the outputs, and also looking at what each neuron is representing. I find this very instructive to understand better what neural networks are doing. So I really recommend you, if you are interested in neural networks, to go take a look on this and to play around a little bit. So in this example, I'm just forming a data set. There are like four possible data sets that we can choose. And this data set has a bunch of blue points in the center, and then surrounding them a bunch of orange points. And of course, we want to separate these two. So of course, with the linear classifier, we cannot do it. So with perception, we cannot do it. This is similar to the XOR problem. There is no linear hyperplane that separates this data. But if you had a hidden layer, then we can already obtain a separating function that does the job. And we can also look at the neurons and look at what is their activation as a function of these two inputs. So we can have these 2D representations because you just have two inputs. And this is neat to understand better. So in this case, pretty much all neurons are learning everything that is very similar to linear surfaces, linear hyperplanes. But combined together, they can do this separation. So this is an easy problem to separate these with a single layer hidden network, hidden layer neural network. But if you try to do this with a more complex target function, like a spiral, this becomes harder to separate. So I spend a few minutes trying to do that with a hidden layer. I tried to increase the number of neurons and so on, but I didn't get anything satisfactory in this example. So this is using a 10H activation, four hidden units, a single layer of four hidden units, and the best we can have is like 46.2% test error, which is terrible. It's just a little bit better than random. And the training loss, it's a little bit lower, but it's still 40, so this didn't even separate the training data. So I would say that the network as it is doesn't have enough capacity to separate, to compute the function that's the target function that you want to estimate. So one thing that we can try to do is to increase the number of hidden layers and see what happens. So if you have two hidden layers instead of one, in this case two neurons on the second layer, I also played around a little bit with these, but I didn't get anything interesting. So the test loss decreases to 41.6 before I think it was 45, so it's a little bit better, but still pretty bad. It's overfitting the training data more, so now the training loss is 30%, but it's still too bad, given that this is just a small set of points. So I would say that this is not solving the problem at all. Maybe it's the activation function. So one thing that we can try is to replace 10H by rectified linear units, because they got very popular. Maybe that's some reason for that. So I kept the same number of hidden units, the same number of layers, just replaced the activation. But it still doesn't get us there. It gets some crazy pattern here, but it's not what you want. Even though the test loss is better, it's now 34%. So it's a very complex function that is being predicted, but not doing what you want. So maybe you need to increase the number of hidden layers even more. So this is what we get with four hidden layers. So with six neurons in each layer, I think it doesn't work very well if you have small numbers of neurons in each layer. So you also need quite a few hidden units. So with four hidden layers, then we finally get something that separates the training data. So in this case, this gets 3% test loss because it's overfitting a little bit on the training data. And the training loss is 0.9, so it's less than 1%. But this kind of gives an idea of how we can increase expressiveness by increasing depth. And also another instructive thing is to look at what is being represented in each neuron. So the neurons that are closer to the inputs, they're just computing hyperplanes. If you look at the neurons that come after, they are starting to learn more complex patterns, like parabolas and second-order functions. And if you keep looking, then you get things that are more interesting. And in the layer just before the output layer, we get something that already looks like a spiral. So maybe this neuron is doing most of the job here. And another interesting thing in this tool is to visualize how many weight is flowing to the different neurons. So the width of each line corresponds to the magnitude of the weight that is flowing to each neuron. So it's really fun to play around with this. So as a summary here, so neural networks are excellent function approximators. I think most of the success of neural networks these days comes from this fact. They are very good at approximating functions. The universal approximation theorem is a very nice result, but it's not constructive in the sense that it just states something that is possible to do with a neural network, but it doesn't tell us how to do. So we still need a learning algorithm that finds the right parameters for the network to learn the target function that we want. And if you want to use a neural network in machine learning, as you usually do, we also need to generalize to unseen data. So it's not enough just to separate training data. We also want to generalize to the arbitrary output space, input space. So to do that, we need to control overfitting. And this is going to be the topic. So there's supposed to be a coffee break now. That was already half an hour ago. So let's pretend it was just now. This was just a recap of the two shameless plugs that I had in the beginning, in case you didn't see it. I'm starting a new course next year. And there's a scholarship available for working in topics related to this talk. OK, so let's move on to training neural networks. So before I move on to this section, is there any pending question about the stuff that I talked about already? OK, so if you have any questions in the course of this, feel free to interrupt. It's much better to, yes? The training loss. Okay, so in these examples that I was showing, the training loss was just the 0-1 loss on the labels. So basically, how many points we classified correctly in each of these two labels divided by the total number of points. Incorrectly. Okay. So for example, here it means that. If you had like 1,000 data points in the training data, we misclassified 9 of those 1,000. And the test loss is the same thing for a separate set of test points that were distributed the same way. Yes?
I have a question. So when you explain the softmax, so this is a mechanism which will output the probability density function at the final layer of train when the training data set does not have a specific label for each sample, but has a certain probability distribution associated to the correct label.
Yep.
So for example, I have this particular sample, and I ask an expert, he says, oh, this is 70% that case or 70% that case. So this could be used to compare with the outputs.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is the case where you have uncertainty about the labels, or maybe you don't have uncertainty, but we want to assign a proportion to each label. And we can still do it with the softmax activation. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about loss functions. And the loss function that is being used there is the cross entropy loss, which is the same that is used if you just have a single deterministic loss. We can also solve problems. I didn't talk much about that, but for example, for the sparse max case, it's convenient for problems that are called multi-label classification problems, in which a single instance can have more than one label. But typically, if you have a large number of possible labels, like for example, in document classification, suppose that you have like many possible topics, and a document can have more than one topic, but typically just a few. So the sparse max is a neat way of handling a problem that promotes you to just assign a sparse number of labels to each document. Yes?
So what were the different results you obtained from using sparse max instead of soft max?
So we are still starting to try sparse max and soft max in more problems. In this kind of problems, where we just want to use it as the output layer, we get in terms of performance, it's similar, but depends on how you measure it. Like for single class, for single label classification problems, they get similar performance. But if you have a problem that involves predicting just like if you allow more than one topic for each document, like the case that I was just mentioning now, it's hard to get that information for a softmax. And with the sparse max, we can just, if you get zero probability to a particular label, you say that the document doesn't have that label, doesn't have that topic, and you just consider the topics, the ones that have non-zero probabilities. So we also use sparse max, and we are going to talk about that in the afternoon, in a different part of the network called the attention mechanism. Where it's suitable to kind of interpret what the network is doing. But this is going to become clearer when you talk about attention mechanisms. Any further questions? Yes? One activation over the other.
Yeah.
So most of the progress that is being done in this is real trial and error. There is not a lot of theory that supports some of these decisions. Some other things are intuitive. Like for example, if you want the output of your hidden unit to represent something probabilistic, you want it to be between 0 and 1, so you'd better use a sigmoid and not a tanh. In general, the default choice for a multi-layer perceptron, I think almost everybody uses that, is the tanh instead of sigmoid. The ReLUs are particularly useful if you have a very deep network because of the vanishing gradient problem. I'm going to explain what the vanishing gradient problem is in the afternoon. But there are some reasons, a little bit intuitive, that lead us to prefer one over the other. But I would say that 90% of it is just trying and see what happens. Okay, any more questions? Yes.
The sparse max plus that you showed us, it shows like a kind of saturation at some point. Doesn't that make you go from two transformation so that it could be you initialize your weight badly at some point you get over there and then degrade it to zero and you will never predict as well?
That's a good question. I'm going to talk a little bit about initialization now. So I'll say that issue is the same, like with sparse max is the same for the other losses, like even soft max could have the same issue. But logistic, tanh, so sigmoid, tanh, and so on, we need to be careful initializing them so that they don't saturate right at the beginning. So in this case, it's not very important if you are saturating exactly, like if you get exactly zero activation or something that is very close to zero, because if you are training your neural network, if you are already very close to zero, you're already having problems if you saturate early in the training phase. So I think I would say that it's not very different That problem is not very different from what you have with softmax. Okay, so let's move on. So I think we have like 35 more minutes. So let's try to finish this training session section part. That will still make us a little bit late from what was planned, but I think it's fine. Okay, so moving on to training neural networks. So here's a quick roadmap. I'm going to talk a little bit about empirical risk minimization. Then stochastic gradient descent, which is the most popular algorithm to train neural networks. Gradient backpropagation, which is a very important step that we need to do to do stochastic gradient descent. I'll talk about the notion of computation graph. I'll talk a little bit about regularization. And then some tricks of the trades, for example, the one that you were just asking regarding initialization. OK, so empirical risk minimization. So this is a general thing that is relevant to any statistical machine learning problem, not necessarily with neural networks. So typically, to set up a learning problem, we define a loss function, an objective function, that combines some loss function with some regularizer. So the goal of the loss function is to make sure that our classifier, which is parameterized by parameters theta, in this case theta contains all the weights and biases in the neural network. So we want our model to fit the data, the training data, as much as possible. So you want to maximize goodness of fit here. And the regularizer is used to penalize the complexity of the model, to make sure that we are not overfitting the training data too much. Because at the end, what we want is to generalize well to unseen test points. So we are using this notation where omega is denoting the regularizer, L of the function f xi, which is a function computed at the output layer by the neural network, and the true label yi. This is the loss function for a single example. And this constant here, it's a scalar, lambda, it's a regularization constant that allows us to control how much regularization we are putting in this problem. So this is basically what allows us to balance between underfitting or overfitting. So is this concept of underfitting and overfitting known by everyone, or should I talk about this? Okay, and since no one says anything, I'm assuming that everyone is familiar with this. So the regularization constant is an hyperparameter that needs to be tuned. And we are going to see that there are many hyperparameters in neural networks that require tuning. So this is just one more. So the second important thing in neural networks is stochastic gradient descent. Optimizers, many optimization algorithms that we can use to optimize an objective function, Newton methods, gradient methods, and so on. In the case of neural networks, in general, if you want to use a neural network, that's because you have enough data to approximate our target function. So this typically means that each pass over the entire training data is going to be a little bit expensive because you need to every time we have a single data point, we need to pass it through the network to get some prediction at the end. And so it's a little expensive to do batch methods here. So for example, if you do gradient methods, like batch gradients, which involves computing all the predictions of the neural network with the current parameter configuration for all points in the training set, on the training set, and only after doing that, computing the error function, the gradients, and updating the parameters, we would only update the parameters of the network after seeing all the training data. So this would be too slow. So in practice, it's useful to use a stochastic method, like stochastic gradient descent. And the difference here is that stochastic gradient descent, instead of computing the gradients of the entire objective function, it approximates it with a noisy gradient, which is based on a single point estimate. So it's basically just looking at a single training point sampled uniformly from the training data, so point I, and it's going to approximate the gradient of the objective function as the gradient only on this point I. So this will be an expression like this that still involves the regularizer, but it only involves the part of the loss function related to these data points. So stochastic gradient descent is just doing this. So it's computing these approximate gradients, and then it's doing a gradient update by moving in the direction of the negative of these gradients using some step size eta, which is called the learning rate, to basically control the amount of the magnitude of the steps that are being taken. So to be able to formalize this in a end-to-end algorithm, there are some things that we need to specify. We need to say which loss function we are using, which regularizer we are using. We need to compute the gradient of the regularizer, and we also need to compute the gradients of the loss function for a single data point. So we need a procedure for computing the gradients with respect to all the parameters of the neural network. So let's start with the loss function. So this is, again, general machine learning. The loss function should match as much as possible the metric that we want to optimize at test time. This doesn't mean that we can use exactly the same metric, because the metric can be intractable to optimize. For example, if we have the Z1 loss, which is the loss that I was showing in the TensorFlow plots in a while ago, so we cannot directly minimize training error, the Z1 loss, because that will be a very tricky optimization problem, very badly behaved. The objective function will not be continuous, will definitely not be smooth. So usually we want to have a surrogate for that metric that we care about by preserving some good properties like continuity. Smoothing sometimes is good. So we want it to be amenable to optimization. So some examples, I would say that the first two are the ones that are traditionally used for most applications: the squared loss for regression, the negative log likelihood, also called cross entropy for multi-class classification, and the sparse max loss for multi-class and multi-label classification. So the squared loss is probably the simplest one. It's a common choice if we want to do regression or reconstruction. So in this case, the neural network is estimating a vector of real numbers. So the function that the neural network is computing is this vector function f, depends on input x and the parameters theta, and we want it to be close to our targets y. So one way of imposing that this is close to this is by penalizing the squared Euclidean distance between the two points, the two vectors. We need to compute the gradient of this loss to use stochastic gradient descent. In this case, the gradient is trivial, so I'm just showing here the partial derivative with respect to each component. So I'm computing the derivative not with respect to theta, because that involves looking at the entire neural network, but only with respect to the activation in the output layer. So in this case, it's the gradient with respect to the function fc, and in this case, it's very simple. It's just this minus this. Okay, so component-wise, it looks like this. So this is for regression. If you are doing multi-class classification, then the typical loss function to use is the negative log likelihood, which is essentially taking the probability computed by the softmax output layer, taking the log of that, and minimizing minus the log. So this corresponds to maximizing the log likelihood. This is how we can write this loss function. So here we assume that y is the true label. We sum over all possible labels. This is an indicator vector. This is one only if c equals y, otherwise it's zero. So only there is only one term here, which is going to be the minus log of the activation, the output of softmax. And we get this simple definition for the loss function. So if we add, if we have probabilities for the labels and certainty over the true labels, this will still work. So we will have a sum here, but instead of having an indicator function, we'll have a distribution Q of Y here, or Q of C, that will be a distribution of the true labels, and we want it to maximize or to minimize the KL divergence between the probability that softmax is outputting and the distribution, actually the other way around. So the KL divergence between this distribution Q and the softmax. And this corresponds to cross entropy. This is the reason why this loss function is also called cross entropy. So let's compute the gradient of this loss at the output pre-activation. So this is the gradient of the loss with respect to ZC. So Z is the outputs after the pre-activation. It's the input to softmax. I'm not going to derive the gradient. It's not hard, but there's no time. So it's very easy to derive this result. The gradient of the softmax of the log of the softmax with respect to Z takes this form. So it's an indicator vector, as one only on the true label Y, minus the output of the softmax on this point Z. So it's very simple to compute. So the sparse max, so I'm go very quickly, so the paper provides a lot more details about this. So there's a natural loss function that makes sense to use with the sparse max. It's not the log likelihood, because sparse max gives you a sparse distribution. It doesn't make sense to take the log of that, because you can go to minus infinity. But there's kind of a natural loss function to use in the case of sparse max, which is a piecewise quadratic function. And the relevant part here is that the gradient of that loss function takes a form which is very similar to softmax. The only difference is that instead of having the softmax here, we have sparse max. But that's the only difference. In two dimensions, we can compare these several loss functions. So this is for classification. T here is parameterizing the difference between the scores for the two classes. This is a binary classification problem, assuming that the correct label is one. And these are the loss functions for several loss functions. The blue one corresponds to the softmax. This corresponds to what logistic regression does. The green line is the hinge loss, which is the loss function used by support vector machines. The dashed line is kind of a least squares loss for classification. And the red line is the loss that corresponds to sparse max, which is a piecewise quadratic function. So before I proceed, is there any pending question? No? Okay, so let's see now how we can compute the full gradient for all with respect to all the parameters of the neural network. This is a very important step to train neural networks. So the parameters are all the weights and biases at all layers. And the way to do this is by using the gradient backpropagation algorithm, which was invented in the 80s. It's a smart idea. The key idea is just to use the chain rule for derivatives. It's actually not more than that. This is just an application of the chain rule for derivatives. So to understand what this means, let's just recap things that maybe we have learned several years ago. So let's recap what the chain rule is. Let's assume that we have some input t. This is just a scalar variable. We are predicting a variable r, which is also a scalar. But the way we are defining this function is by composing two other functions. So we define a function u. So this is a function u of t, which is defined as t squared. This is v of t, which is a linear, an affine function of t. And then r is defined as the product of these two functions. So how can we compute the partial derivative of r with respect to t? Is this basic? Do you still remember how this works? Any guess? Anyone wants to take a guess for this? Almost that. There is a small subtlety. You sum the two derivatives. You also need to multiply. You have this second term that is the derivative of u with respect to t and v with respect to t. But yeah, that's the intuition. So basically, if you have some flow, and we are going to connect this with the computational graph, which is an important concept in neural networks, the trick to compute the derivative with the output with respect to the input is to go through each, consider all paths going from the input to the output, and to sum over all these paths. And for if you just had like a single path, if you didn't have V, the chain rule will be very simple. It will just be this term here. But if you have two ways of reaching V, then you need to sum over the two. So in this case, you need to compute the derivative of R with respect to U times the derivative of U with respect to T, and the other path, derivative of R with respect to V times the derivative of V with respect to T. So, and now it becomes very simple, because if of each of these functions is a very simple function, these two, it gives 2 times T times V plus 3 times U, and if you do the math, you end up at the final result. So this, it's exactly the same trick that we use in the gradient propagation algorithm to train neural networks. So there is no magic involved. And the general result is that if you have, if a function R of T can be written as a function of intermediate results, we call QI of T each of these intermediate results, then the partial derivative of the derivative of R with respect to T is the sum for all terms like this. So it's basically the dissociation of these for more than 2 possible ways. And the way we are going to invoke that to compute the gradient in neural networks is by setting T to an output unit in a layer, in any layer in the neural network. So we are going to do this layer-wise. We are going to set QI of T, the pre-activation in the layer just above that, and we are going to use RT to be the loss function that you want to optimize. So this way, we can start from the top of the neural network on the output layer, and using these intermediate results to compute all the gradients from up to bottom. So let's see how we can do this. So let's start with the. So we already saw for a softmax output layer, we already saw to compute the gradient in the output layer. It's the gradient of the loss. But now we need to propagate that to the rest of the network. So just a recap, at a layer L plus 1, this is the definition of the pre-activation. It's just an affine function of the output of the previous hidden layer using the parameters, the weights and biases of that layer. So we want to compute the derivative of the loss function with respect to the jth hidden units at layer L. And to do that, we are going to use the chain rule. So we are going to sum for all possible units I. These are units on the layer L plus 1. So you want to compute the derivative with respect to the activation in layer L, but we are summing over the number of units in the layer just above that. We are computing the derivative. So one of the terms is going to be the derivative of the loss with respect to the pre-activation Zi at layer L plus 1 times the derivative of Zi at layer L plus 1 with respect to Hj at layer L. So this corresponds to an edge connecting two neurons in consecutive layers. And so we assume that this quantity has been computed already. We are going to see how this can be computed recursively. And now we need to worry about this derivative. But if you look at the expression, the derivative of Zi with respect to Hj is just going to be the coordinates ij of the matrix W. So this derivative is just going to be Wij. So it's very simple. This becomes much compact if you write in vector notation. So we can write the gradient of the loss with respect to the entire set of hidden units H at layer L. So this is horizontal, so it's basically this vector. It's just collecting all the results here. We can write this in matrix notation as W L plus 1 transposed times the gradient of the loss function with respect to Z. Okay? So there is a linear relation between these two gradients. So I am going very slowly here, but if you use matrix derivatives, this can be done in a single line. But I think it's important to understand better how things work by looking at these connections directly. So let's now look at the hidden layer gradient before the activation. So before we are computing the gradient of the loss with respect to H, now let's compute it with respect to Z. So we want to compute now the derivative of the loss with respect to zj. And this is even simpler, because there is only one way of going from z to h, which is applying the nonlinearity at each hidden unit. So you don't need to sum. So in this case, this equals the partial derivative with respect to hj, which is the activation right after zj, times the derivative of hj with respect to zj. Right? And let's recall that hj and zj are related by just applying this nonlinearity, this activation function. So here, this is just g prime of zj. Okay, so at the end, you just get this expression. And you can write it in gradient notation, in vector notation, using this formula. So this equals the gradient of the loss with respect to h, pointwise multiplication by g prime of z, where basically we are concatenating in a vector all the derivatives for each of these hidden units. So we can represent this multiplication that is individual at each unit in vector notation by taking the pointwise product. Okay, so the only thing that's remaining here is how to compute the derivative of the activation function. We have seen several possible activation functions, so let's start with the simplest one, the linear activation. Well, this is too simple. The derivative is just one. Let's look at the sigmoid. So in the case of sigmoid, it's a good exercise to do. So if you compute this by hand, we'll realize that you can express the derivative of g as g of z itself. So this is the output of the sigmoid times 1 minus g of z. So this is, maybe you have seen these before when you studied logistic regression. So this is a very famous result. Notice that we are only looking at the output of these gates, of this activation. We are not involving any term that depends directly on z. You're just depending on z via g of z. For 10h, we get something similar. So the gradient becomes 1 minus gz squared. So in all these cases, it's very cheap, very efficient to compute these derivatives. If you have special devices like GPUs, it's even better, because everything can be done element-wise. So for the case of rectified linear units, so the derivative is not defined everywhere. You don't have a derivative at zero. But everywhere else, so if our z is negative, the derivative is going to be zero. If it's positive, it's going to be one. So it's also very simple to compute. Okay, so now we saw how to compute gradients with respect to the activations and pre-activations. But if you want to do stochastic gradient descent, you need to compute derivatives with respect to the parameters. So how can we use those results to compute the parameter gradient? So recapping again, this is how the pre-activation is related to the activation in the previous layer. This is where the parameters arise, the weights and the biases. To compute this derivative, with respect to component ij, we just do the derivative of the loss with respect to zi times the derivative of zi with respect to this. And this derivative is just going to be hj. So no surprises here. So in vector notation, we can write it as the gradient. So this is going to be a matrix, because the argument is a matrix. So the gradient of the loss with respect to matrix W is going to be another matrix. And that matrix is rank one. It's going to be the column vector which is containing the gradient of the loss with respect to z times a row vector containing the response of the hidden units at layer L minus one. And similarly, the gradient with respect to the biases, it's almost the same, except that the biases are not multiplying by h, so we don't have h here. So it's going to be a vector which equals the gradient of the loss with respect to z. So does this make clear how the gradients are being computed in the neural network? So basically, and putting everything together, the backpropagation algorithm is going to look like this. First, we compute the output gradient. In the case of the softmax output loss, the gradient looks like this. And then we need to go top-down in the neural network and start computing gradients layer after layer until we reach the input layer. So we start by computing the gradients with respect to the hidden layer parameters. This is going to reuse the gradients of the loss with respect to z that we have already here. Then the next step is to compute the gradient of the hidden layer. This computes the gradient with respect to h given the gradient with respect to z. And finally, we compute the gradient of the hidden layer below. So the gradient with respect to z reuses the gradient with respect to h on that layer. And we keep looping this until we compute the gradients of all the parameters. So is there any question about the backpropagation? Is this clear? This is the kind of topic that it's either too boring if you already know about it, or if you don't know anything about it, you don't understand because there's a lot of math in slides. So I'm hoping that we are more on the first situation here and not the second. So the punchline is that using the Schön rule offers a very computationally cheap way of computing all the gradients that we need. So an important concept in neural networks is that of a computation graph. So if you think about all the computation that takes place to compute the output of a neural network, it can be represented as a directed acyclic graph. So we start with some inputs. In this case, I'm putting the inputs as a vector. This involves all the input units. Then we multiply it by a matrix W and a bias B. These are the parameters of the network. And by doing that, we obtain a layer preactivation. Then we apply a nonlinearity that gives us H. And then we have a second layer that does the same thing until we get f of x. And then we have a loss function defined on f of x. So this all moves forward in one direction. There are no loops in this graph. So this is nice because if you regard each of these things as a box, we can implement forward propagation in a modular way. So forward propagation is the operations that you need to perform to get some outputs in the neural network, to start with inputs and get some response. So each of these boxes can be an object in your favorite programming language that has, so it can be a class with a method called fprop that computes the value of the box given its children. So it's very simple. If you are doing this multiplication, the output is going to be W times Z. If you call the fprop method of each box in the right order, which in this case is bottom up, then we get the forward backpropagation algorithm, and we get the prediction from the neural network. So this is nice, but the most nice aspect is that you can also do the same thing to compute the gradient. So we can still use this computation graph for the gradient backpropagation. So in this case, each box can also have a bprop method that computes the loss gradient with respect to its children, given the loss gradient with respect to the output. So we specify what's the differential, how much the loss varies at the output of each box, and the loss gives back how much the input changes. So this is basically computing, if you are dealing with vectors, the Jacobian of each box. So this is neat, and you can make use of cached computation during the fprop method. Like, for example, we saw that the derivative of the sigmoids and the tanh, they just depend on the outputs on those activations. So the derivative of the sigmoid of z, you don't need z itself, you just need the result of the sigmoid of z. So we can cache that result in the forward propagation step and just reuse it in the back propagation to make it more efficient. And so if we call bprop in the reverse order, which means top down in this case, then we get immediately the backpropagation algorithm. We only need to reach the parameters. And this is nice because if you have a framework for neural networks in which each box is implemented in this modular way, specifying these two methods, then you get automatic differentiation automatically. So you can just have atomic functions at each box. And if you want to compute all the gradients to do the updates in stochastic gradient descent, you don't need to worry about getting the backpropagation algorithm right. So now is the moment where we think again about those equations that I wrote in the previous slides and think that this was a waste of time because you can do it automatically with automatic differentiation. I think it was not a waste of time because we learned something when you see all these derivatives being computed. But in practice, if you are using a software tool like Theano, TensorFlow, Torch, and so on, it's very rarely the case that you need to compute any derivative by hand. Unless we are introducing some new activation function that is not implemented already. So some of you might have heard about some of these toolkits, Theano, TensorFlow. They all support automatic differentiation in slightly different ways. It's not the same for everything. So for Torch and TensorFlow, for example, they do symbolic calculus, which means that the gradients for each function are functions themselves. So it's not just a method that computes the gradient. It becomes a computation graph just for doing the backpropagation. Not all packages are like that, so Torch is different. But in all cases, we don't need to worry about autocompute gradients. So just to give a flavor, you might not see all the code here. This is just some screenshots that I took from Theano's website. So this is the code necessary to implement logistic regression. It's actually pretty big. I think by using some, so this is doing everything from scratch. If you use primitives that are already implemented in Theano, this will be just 5 or 6 lines. But if you want to do everything from scratch, then it sort of looks like this. You generate your data randomly. You define your inputs. This is symbolic variables. So this is a matrix specifying the data set, all the features times number of data points. The Y is a vector of classes. So this is doing logistic regression. So this is going to be a class for every data point. And then we need to have variables for the weights as well and the biases. These are defined as shared variables. There is some reason for that I'm not going to talk about now. And then we build the computation graph by specifying what the logistic function looks like. So each of these boxes, t.exp, t.dot, and so on, those are symbolic functions implemented in Theano. So this is importing this package tensor and these are primitives in Theano. So all these are symbolic functions. By the time we execute this, we are not computing any number. We are just representing a function as a computation graph. I forgot to mention that this is Python code, in case you didn't recognize it. Actually, most of these toolkits that I listed before support Python, which is a really nice language to quickly implement things like this. So as I was saying, this is just building a computation graph. So it's building the decision for making a prediction. It's defining the cross entropy loss function. And then this thing here is defining the gradient with respect to the cost. The gradient of the cost with respect to the parameters. And this is also going to be a computation graph. This is why they are working with symbolic fully symbolic functions. The only place where the computation graph gets created is by calling this function primitive in Theano. So this is building the computation graph by taking all the outputs, taking the inputs, and building everything in one piece. It's also optimizing the computation graph. There are sometimes many things that can be optimized in this creation process. And then this is where we are starting to evaluate things using that computation graph. So this is automatically computing gradients, doing updates. The updates are defined here. So when you create the function, we also define how we do updates based on the gradients that are stored here and on the original configuration of the parameters. So it's very neat. So for logistic regression, maybe you don't need this. But if you have a neural network with more hidden units, it becomes neat to use something like this. This is the equivalent in TensorFlow, not quite equivalent. They are doing linear regression here. It's pretty much the same thing. There are a lot of things that are built in already. So there's already a gradient descent optimizer. There are also more sophisticated optimizers implemented there already. And in Keras, it's even nicer. Actually, if you want to build something fast, Keras is a pretty good solution. It works, so you can immediately define layers. So in this case, this is adding a dense layer. This is the first, this has 20 input units and 64 hidden units. This is the first hidden layer. Then it's setting an activation, a 10H activation for all the units in that layer. Then it's setting dropout. I'm going to talk about dropout in a minute, or maybe in the afternoon. So then another dense layer, another activation layer, another dropout. This is the second layer of hidden units. And then a softmax activation as the outputs. And then, again, all the optimization algorithms, stochastic gradient descent and so on, they are already built in. So it's just a few lines of code to build a two-layer neural network in Keras. OK, so let's see. Maybe I should finish this. I think it's not. Or maybe not, I don't know. So this was supposed to end at noon 15, or?
It was noon 15, yes.
Is it OK to do it at noon 30, or should we just make a break? What do you prefer? Staying 15 more minutes here,
yeah.
Or?
Okay.
Yeah? OK, good. So OK, so let's talk quickly about regularization. So far, we just talked about loss function. Now we're going to talk about how to regularize to prevent overfitting. So we're going to talk about L2 regularization, L1 regularization, and dropout, where dropout is, you know, the most exciting from these three. So, yeah.
So actually, I have a question. So you show us this code. So can you give me an idea how much does it take, how much time does it take to train a neural network, let's say, with medium size, whatever that is?
So medium size is very ill-defined. So, but so these examples here, this was a very small neural network, like a.
So medium size means not something Google will do.
Okay.
Medium company.
I think definitions of medium and large are always changing, but I think like the time is more fixed than your definition of medium and small. So typically, medium is anything that you can do in 1 hour, and large is something that takes 1 day. Regardless of how many data points you need for each of them, that keeps changing. But let's say that we want to do this toy problem here. I don't know how many data points are being generated here, but let's say you have like 1,000 data points, and like two layers, and like 20 dimensions, as the case here for your inputs. This will take seconds. I'm already talking about how many runs you need to do until things converge. I'm going to talk a little bit more on, you know, some tricks that you need to do at optimization and so on to make it work. And also some things that influence the computation cost. Like, for example, if you are doing the computations in the GPU, if you're using the CPU. So for example, if you have a small, like a medium problem, so to speak, using TensorFlow is completely overkill. So with TensorFlow, we can lose 5 minutes just initializing your computation graph. You consume all the memory in your laptop and so on just to initialize, and then the computation is almost instantaneous. But so TensorFlow is particularly good if you have a large problem and if you have GPUs to run. So if you have anything close to large, running these on GPUs is going to be very important. So I'm going to talk later in the afternoon problems like machine translation, speech recognition. So actually, I'm not going to talk about speech recognition, but let's take machine translation, for example. You can train it. You don't need like a cluster of machines to train your models with the data that is publicly available, which is millions of sentences. You cannot do it in your laptop either, because you don't have GPUs in your laptop, and this is going to be painfully slow. But you can use a regular computer with some RAM, with GPUs, and for training a full end-to-end MT system, it will take you 1 week. But the performance will not be that far from state-of-the-art from Google. So you don't need, you know, huge computation power to, you know. I think the major difference here is that Google uses a lot more data to train their MT systems, and of course, this, if you have more data, it takes longer to train your neural network. But you can already get something decent with not very expensive hardware. Okay, so regularization. So in the case of L2 regularization, this corresponds to Gaussian prior on the weights. So we define it this way, squared Euclidean norm, like Frobenius norm of the matrix W at each layer. And the gradient is going to be W itself. If you compute the updates that you need to do in stochastic gradient descent, you realize that the gradient of the regularizer goes here, and you can combine these two terms, and you get an update rule that looks like this. It looks like 1 minus the learning rate times the regularization coefficients times W. This part is just scaling the matrix minus the gradient part. This is the part that we get with gradient backpropagation. So you kind of see that this is the effect of a weight decay. So the regularization part is coming here, and the way it works is by scaling down the magnitude of your weights. So that's the intuition, to regularize, scale your weight vector before doing any updates. So with L1 regularization, it's not differentiable everywhere, but that's not a problem. So it just the derivative becomes a sine function. So for entries that are positive, the gradient is plus 1. For entries that are negative, the gradient is minus 1. And this is going to promote sparsity of the weights. So this is a general fact about L1 regularization. So I'm not going to talk much about this because this is not very specific to deep learning. So dropout regularization is more interesting. This was introduced not in 2014, but sometime before. So 2014 is the date of the journal paper. And it's a very interesting idea. So this is what our standard neural net looks like. The idea in dropout is to randomly drop some neurons, just that. So when we are doing the forward pass and also the backward pass, define a probability distribution. With probability p, we drop a neuron. With probability 1 minus p, you keep it. And this is going to reduce drastically the number of connections that you're going to consider. Of course, you do this, so you flip this coin for every data point. So on average, all the neurons will get activated the same amount of times. But this is kind of forcing. The intuition here is that this is kind of preventing hidden units to co-adapt to other units by forcing them to be more generally useful. So this is making sure that each hidden unit makes some effort to represent the inputs without relying too much on the other units on the same layer. So at test time, we don't want to do this. We don't like having something stochastic at test time, or some of us don't. So we can just keep all units, but multiply their outputs by 1 minus p to make sure that the scale is approximately the same. The scale is the same that you get at training time when you drop these units with probability p. So there are some theory that explains why this works, that tries to relate that with the other regularization that is included as a term in the objective function. So there is a nice ICML paper about that. There's another note, if you want to use these things in practice, most software packages implement another variant, which is actually nicer, in my opinion, which is called inverted dropout, where instead of just doing what I just described, at training type, they still drop the networks with probability p, but they also divide their output by 1 minus p, so that the scale is essentially the same as if all units were active. And then at test time, you don't need to do anything. You just use the full neural network. So this is called inverted dropout. It's implemented by most software packages. So if you work with these things in practice, make sure that we are using the right form of dropout. So if you are not doing inverted dropout, don't forget about this step. If you are doing inverted dropout, don't do that step. It's very easy to do these kind of mistakes. So to implement dropouts in practice, you can do it by defining random binary masks for each layer. So we define a mask vector m for each layer that is a vector of 0 and 1s, and it's going to encode which hidden units are active and which are inactive. In practice, it was observed that in many data sets, this beats regular backpropagation, just because it doesn't overfit that often. It's also sometimes better than, or often better than, L2 regularization and other classical forms of regularization. And there are other variants that people have come up with, like drop connects, stochastic pooling, and so on, that uses similar ideas of dropping parts of the network. So just to give a flavor about how we can convert the previous backpropagation algorithm into backpropagation with dropout, it doesn't require a lot of changes. The only things that we need to do is to include the mask to compute the vector h l minus 1. This is something that we already need to do in the forward step. And the only change is when computing the gradient of the hidden layer below, before the activation, we need to do an additional pointwise product with the mask. Because if a hidden unit was disabled, then it should not contribute to the gradient updates. OK, so I think I need to do a break before finishing this section, because I have too many things here. So maybe like, what, 2 more minutes and then we break? OK. So let's take these 2 minutes to talk about initialization. So the rule of thumb here, sorry, yes. Trial and error. So yeah, so 0.5 will be my first choice if I had 5 minutes before some bomb blows up. But yeah, it's a matter of trying. It's another hyperparameter that needs to be tuned. So so the rule of thumb is initializing all the biases to zero. So it doesn't work to initialize all the weight vectors to zero. Don't do that. So basically, if you do that, all the gradients are going to be zero, and we're going to get a saddle point, and they're not going to be able to train the neural network. So this has been known for a while. It's also not good to initialize all the weights to the same deterministic value, all to the same value, because this is going to create a symmetry. And to exploit the power of neural networks, you need to break that symmetry. So the right way of doing that is to use random initialization. It can be Gaussian, uniform, and so on. If you are using an activation like sigmoid or tanh, then you should sample around zero to get the linear part of the activation, or the region that is more similar to linear, so not to saturate the networks right in the beginning of training. So the idea of doing random is just to break the symmetry, sampling around zero. For ReLU activations, it's a little bit different, because ReLUs look like this. So the zero is the point where we start getting a linearity. So we need to go a little bit to the right. We should initialize it to a small positive number with enough variance so that we can capture part of the saturation. But we need to be careful with variance. If you have too high variance, then very quickly all the neuron activations are going to fall in the saturation region, and we're not going to be able to train. So it's a little tricky to initialize. There's a recipe that works often in practice. This is what I usually do, which is to initialize all the weights uniformly between minus t and t, where t is computed by this formula. So this comes from a paper by Glorot and Benju. So this is basically counting how many units you have in the next layer. This is how many units you have in the previous layer. And just do this formula. It works well in practice with tanh and sigmoids. Actually, for tanh, I think there is a correction. No, for sigmoids, there's some constant. You need to multiply this by 2 or something. So you can take a look at the actual paper to see it more carefully. OK, so maybe you can stop here. Yes?
What do you mean by saturation?
Oh, sorry. OK, so that's a good point. So saturation means so saturation is this region here, where the response becomes either plus 1 or minus 1. And this is the region that I'm calling approximately linear. Like if you go close to 0, this is nearly linear. When you start approaching this area, then it starts saturating. And the thing that you need to avoid is to train with all your neurons saturated. OK, any further question before we break?
So, I have a question. Because I think this is a request for many people. Are you going to make available slides?
Yes, maybe with slight changes after this, just because, so I did the slides very quickly. For some of the sessions, I took a lot of slides from other people, and I'm not sure if I'm giving all the credit that I should give. So I need just to make sure that before making this public, I'm not stealing material for other people without giving credit. But yeah.